Listening Library presents Junko Tabei Masters the Mountains by Rebel Girls. Read for you by Traci Kato-Kiriyama. To the Rebel Girls of the World, no mountain is too high if you put one foot in front of the other. Junko Tabei, September 22, 1939. To October 20th, 2016, Japan. Chapter 1.
Who wants to go on a field trip to the mountains?
Mr. Watanabe asked his fourth grade class. Junko's hand shot up in the air. She wasn't sure why, since going to the mountains probably meant lots of hiking and climbing, and she was bad at sports. Really bad. PE was her least favorite subject at school. She couldn't do the gymnastics other kids could do, and she much preferred reading to running.
This is not a good idea, she thought.
She lowered her hand and pretended to sweep her bangs out of her eyes. But she really did want to try. It sounded like fun. She raised her hand again and made herself keep it there. Her heart thumped wildly in her chest. The teacher nodded and smiled at her.
Ms. Ishibashi, excellent. Anyone else?
Other students raised their hands too. Two boys sitting in front of Junko smirked and whispered to each other. She could guess what they were saying.
There's no way Junko can climb a mountain. She's tiny and weak. Plus, she's a girl.
Gentlemen, do you have something you'd like to share with the class?
Mr. Watanabe asked.
No, sir.
The two boys sat up straight in their seats.
That's good to hear. And since it seems like enough of you are interested in doing some mountaineering, I'll contact your parents and organize the details for our trip this summer.
Junko squirmed.
Mountaineering?
The word made it sound so serious. She was nervous, but also excited. After school, she walked home with her friend Hideo. They followed a path along the river, like they always did. Colorful petals from flowering fruit trees rained down around them from above.
Just ignore those guys,
Hideo said. He must have noticed the whispering in class.
I'll try,
Junko said, still a little nervous about the trip.
Have you ever done any mountaineering?
Yeah. On Castle Mountain,
Hideo joked. Junko laughed with her friend. Castle Mountain wasn't really a mountain. It was more like a hill, and it was in the middle of their town, Miharu, in north-central Japan. From the top, you could see the whole town. Farms, temples, houses, shops, and even their elementary school. Junko had hiked up Castle Mountain a bunch of times with Hideo and her other friends. She liked seeing the world from up high. But Castle Mountain wasn't that high. It was small, just like Junko herself. The mountain Mr. Watanabe wanted to take them to would surely be much bigger. From the top, you could probably see all of Japan. That night at dinner, Junko told her family about the field trip.
Are you sure you want to go, Jun-chan?
Her mother, Kyo, asked. She ladled steaming white rice into a blue earthenware bowl, added a pickled plum, and passed the bowl to Junko.
It doesn't seem like your sort of thing.
Well, I think it sounds like quite the adventure,
her father, Morinobu, said as he lifted a piece of grilled mackerel with his chopsticks. Behind his glasses, his brown eyes were cheerful. Around the crowded table, everyone began talking at once. Junko's brothers and sisters, the two housekeepers who lived with them, and some of her father's employees from his printing company who also lived with them.
Will it be Mount Fuji or Mount Kita or some other mountain?
My friend climbed Mount Fuji once.
What if you run into a bear?
What if you run into lots of bears?
What if everyone reaches the top except for you?
Yeah, didn't you flunk gym class?
Isn't mountain climbing a man's sport?
Junko lowered her head
and concentrated on her rice as the conversation swirled around her. She was the second youngest of 7 children, and she often got lost in her thoughts. The pickled plum was extra salty and sour, the way she liked it, but she barely noticed. She was too busy answering questions in her head.
Why shouldn't girls climb mountains? This is 1949, not medieval times, she thought. And so what if I'm not a super-duper mega athlete? I can still put one foot in front of the other. If I have to take tons of breaks, or if I'm the last one to reach the top, that's fine. At least I'll have tried my best.
Junko trusted Mr. Watanabe, who was her favorite teacher. Actually, he was pretty much everyone's favorite teacher. He was different from the other instructors at their school, and it wasn't just his long, shaggy hair. On nice days, he often took their class to Castle Mountain for picnic lunches. There, under the flowering trees, he would tell his students thrilling tales about the mountains he'd climbed and the cities he'd visited. He would also describe his favorite books, like The Diary of Anne Frank and The Broken Commandment, and Junko and the others would cry at the sad parts, even if they didn't totally understand them. Mr. Watanabe was just about the smartest person she knew. If he believed she could hike to the top of a mountain, then she could hike to the top of a mountain, right? Chapter 2. Mr. Watanabe kept his promise. That summer, he took Junko and some of her classmates to the Nasu Mountain Range in Nikko National Park. They rode a train and a bus to get to their destination. Junko stared out the window at the blur of houses and farms they passed by. She had never traveled this far from home, so everything about the journey was exciting and new. The man selling bento box lunches at the train station, the leathery smell of the bus seats, the pretty countryside. They finally reached the base of the mountain range. Junko couldn't believe how enormous it was. It made Castle Mountain seem like an anthill. There were lots of other visitors there, too, carrying backpacks and walking sticks, just like they were. After a quick snack of clementines, rice crackers, and barley tea, the group from Miharu headed for the mountainside inn where they would spend the night. The big hike to the top of Asahi Peak wasn't until tomorrow. As they neared the inn, Hideo called out, "Hey, check it out! The ground is warm!" Junko knelt down and touched the ground. It was warm, and not just from the sun. The others knelt and touched the ground, too, gasping in awe. "This mountain range is volcanic," Mr. Watanabe explained. "There's hot water running beneath the surface."
"Did you say volcanic? Will it erupt?" Junko asked.
"No, it won't erupt. But it has created onsen, or hot springs, all over this place. Tourists come from everywhere to bathe in them." Mr. Watanabe was right. Junko had thought only cold water ran in rivers, but this part of Japan had hot water rivers and hot water ponds, too. The area was full of them, and in fact, there were several onsen outside their inn. Grown-ups sat in them, sipping drinks out of wooden cups and looking relaxed and happy. That night at their inn, Junko's group cooked their own dinner. They had packed miso bean paste, rice, curry mix, and vegetables in their backpacks along with their clothes. Junko had never cooked at home, but she found that she loved cooking, especially with her classmates. They peeled potatoes and carrots to make into a curry to serve over rice. They sliced eggplants to fry. They diced tomatoes for a salad. Who knew that something so simple could be so much fun? After dinner, they all went for a soak in one of the onsen. As the steam rose around them and the stars glittered like diamonds in the night sky, Junko thought that she'd never felt more peaceful. This trip wasn't just about climbing a mountain. It was about being with her friends and enjoying nature together.
"Come on, Jun-chan! You've got this!"
Junko stopped in the middle of the steep, rocky trail, gasping for breath. She bent down and grabbed her knees, and her sun hat fell to the ground. From above, her classmates shouted encouragingly. She wiped her brow with the back of her hand. She wasn't sure she could do this. Her lungs hurt, her legs ached, and she could feel painful blisters forming on her feet under her thin socks and running shoes. She couldn't move another step. Also, why had she worn a dress? Pants would have been much more practical. She, Junko Ishibashi, was obviously not cut out for this mountaineering.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.